Speaking to a hall of cardiologists primarily, I think this is just setting the tone, trying to get your attention to how diabetes, you know, is a conducive environment for cardiovascular disease and how is it different in women. So without much ado, well, seemingly it may see, I mean, it appears that probably there are more men with diabetes than women in the world, and so is the case in Southeast Asia as well, the topmost for diabetes. But look at the lifetime risk in young women, especially when confounded with obesity or overweight. It's accentuated even more. If you now consider the number of deaths due to diabetes in adults, again, yellow is women, pink is men, you can see that there is more death due to diabetes in women than men. Now let's understand biological sex versus gender differences. Well, biological sex causes the sex differences attributable to the genetic and the hormonal attributes, and it impacts not only the disease pathophysiology, clinical manifestations, and the response to therapy as well. Gender, on the other hand, is an outcome of lifestyle, environment, nutritional habits, exercise, smoking, etc., etc. And that the gender constructs determine the patient's perception of the disease, the help-seeking behavior, also the use or access to healthcare, decision-making, and therapeutic response as well. So here you can see that all the factors impact both the sexes differently, males as well as females. Well, specifically the metabolic challenges in a woman's life cycle present themselves at puberty, menstrual cycles, preconception, pregnancy, breastfeeding, perimenopause, and postmenopause period. Looking at the global trends in obesity, although obesity is a rising problem around the world, in India itself, there are at least 9 million more women who are obese as compared to the men. So it's a huge, huge problem here. And the dual burden of malnutrition and overweight and obesity in women is also more prominent, is higher in women, whether it's malnutrition or overnutrition. Both are more prevalent in women in urban as well as rural areas as well. Generalized obesity and abdominal obesity and the prevalence of metabolic syndrome. Metabolic syndrome with its components of dysglycemia, dyslipidemia, obesity, and hypertension, and liver fat, etc. So again, the prevalence in women is very high. And why are we talking about obesity, and why am I digressing from diabetes? Because the relationship, large studies like the Nurses' Health Study and the Health Professionals Follow-Up Study have clearly shown that with every BMI increase, in BMI unit increase, the women in green, you can see that the risk for type 2 diabetes increases exponentially as compared to the men. And these numbers are only going to increase further as projected by these and given in the 10th Atlas of the IDF. Coming to polycystic ovarian syndrome, a complex metabolic disorder characterized by hyperandrogenemia, visceral obesity, and insulin resistance. It creates a conducive milieu internally that is not only more prone to diabetes, but also a perfect combination or a perfect storm for cardiovascular disease. Women with PCOS have 4 times higher risk of diabetes than their controls. Well, pregnancy, hyperglycemia in pregnancy affects 16.7% of the women globally, and Southeast Asia has the highest prevalence, 28%. And we know in India it varies up to 18 to 20% as well. So why is this hyperglycemia in pregnancy important? Well, the maternal lifestyle, given over a genetic predisposition, and this lifestyle, whether healthy or unhealthy during the preconception and gestational period, impacts the fetal programming in the baby and renders the baby, in case of unhealthy lifestyle choices, renders the baby more susceptible to childhood obesity, early onset of diabetes, and cardiovascular risk. And this vicious cycle, this baby goes on to becoming an unhealthy parent as it grows further. So, you know, the cycle continues with all these epigenetic modifications that it causes at the time of the fetus. So this fetal programming period or the hyperglycemia in pregnancy has to be tackled extremely critically. Well, again, a BMG 2020 publication from Kamlesh Kunti, Melanie Davis and group clearly showed that if the chance of getting type 2 diabetes when you have GDM is 10 times higher than in the healthy controls. And similarly, the risk for cardiovascular disease, the relative risk is 1.98, which is significantly higher in those with prior GDM. In fact, even if you had GDM and you did not develop diabetes in the subsequent few years, your risk for future cardiovascular events is as high as 56%. I think that's a significant number to deal with. And that too in the first decade postpartum, so you're still in your middle age. The Singapore Chinese health study clearly showed that higher the parity, higher the risk for type 2 diabetes. In fact, pre-gestational diabetes, that is diabetes before pregnancy, and non-alcoholic fatty liver disease are also very closely interrelated. And women with GDM, in fact, the risk of NAFLD increases twofold. The other factors for NAFLD are menopause, metabolic syndrome, older age, ethnicity, unhealthy diet, sedentary lifestyle, and of course, genetic predisposition. And you can see that estrogens, the ones protecting against NAFLD, are all gone or low at the time of menopause, which increases the risk further. In fact, the diabetic female, as compared to a diabetic male, has much greater liver fat. And this has been seen in the study which did the MRI at the L5, L4 lumbar spine. And this, because of the gradual decline of ovarian, the occurrence of ovarian senescence and the decline in the estrogen levels, increases the fat as well as the steatohepatic fibrosis in the aging woman. This brings me to menopause and diabetes. Several factors like central deposition of fat, increase in the visceral fat, increase in the testosterone, decrease in SHBG, and that entire inflammatory milieu within renders the woman more prone to diabetes in that perimenopause or postmenopausal period as anything else. And also to cardiovascular risk if in case the lifestyle is really, really unhealthy. Early menopause and premature ovarian insufficiency are also associated with a higher risk of type 2 diabetes, and a later menopause at 55 years of age is also associated with higher risk of diabetes. Diabetes, again, at menopause is associated with very low HDL levels and high levels of LDL, again increasing the cardiovascular risk in the woman. Consequences of diabetes. As far as microvascular complications go, well, increase in neuropathy and nephropathy are seen much higher in women as compared to men with diabetes. But the most important is the macrovascular risk or the cardiovascular risk shown by the Framingham study right in the beginning, 20, 30 years ago, that if you are a man with diabetes, your risk for cardiovascular disease increases only twofold. But if you are a woman with diabetes, then your risk for cardiovascular disease increases 4 to 5 times. Well, this is further corroborated by a very recent systematic review and meta-analysis, which said that women with diabetes as compared to men with diabetes had 13% greater risk of all-cause mortality, 30% significantly greater excess risk of cardiovascular mortality, 58% greater risk of coronary heart disease, and 8% greater risk of stroke mortality. Again, corroborated by another meta-analysis as well. Diabetes as a risk factor for stroke was also studied, and women with diabetes seem to have greater stroke incidence than the men with diabetes. And smoking in women seems to have a much worse outcome because it's associated with a high risk of early heart disease, as smoking decreases the estrogen levels and even precipitates early menopause. The female specific risk factors associated with cardiovascular disease, and you can see across the spectrum of cardiovascular disease, it's PCOS, gestational diabetes, pregnancy-induced hypertension or preeclampsia, and preterm birth. Cardia study, again, a wonderful study that showed that the risk for cardiovascular disease is very high in women, and you can predict this if they've had a preterm birth or if they had a small for gestational age baby. And in fact, if they had both, the risk would be more than 10%. Coming to the gender differences in diabetes, as far as depression and anxiety go, women with diabetes experience twice as much as depression and anxiety as women without diabetes. Again, sexual dysfunction is highly prevalent in women with diabetes. It's also prevalent in men with diabetes. The incidence is up to 50%, but in women, you can see that this systematic review and meta-analysis published just in 2019 showed that it was as high as 68.6%. And if we ask ourselves, none of us are even asking or leading that or eliciting that history from our patients today. So again, because of vascular dysfunction or psychological distress or vaginal dryness, infections, decreased desire and ovulation, early menopause, and the havoc created by the ovarian hormones, all these lead to sexual dysfunction in females with diabetes, and it's an important outcome that must be asked. Osteoporosis and fracture risk, well, women with type 2 diabetes have more than 30% increased risk of major osteoporotic fracture and more than 90% increased risk of hip fractures compared to those without diabetes. And again, drugs have to be very carefully chosen for those with diabetes. Diabetes and cancer, we know again the relationship is well established by several reviews and meta-analysis. And in fact, as far as women is concerned, the risk is high as far as breast, bladder, colon, colorectal, gallbladder, and so on. Cancers of these organs are much higher in women with diabetes than otherwise, and all the reasons for the same are listed here. So why the inertia to prevent diabetes? Well, there are several barriers. Again, these also have been studied. So we know, we have quite a bit of information about it, but we are just not intervening in the right manner and the right time. So due to lack of time, which comes under personal barriers, there may be health system barriers, there may be socio-cultural barriers, economic barriers, psychological barriers, so on and so forth. But women do not prevent diabetes. There is also pay inequality which exists, and this is a global phenomenon. It's not just in India. Decision making may be more with the male partner at home rather than the woman, and healthcare expenditure, drug costs, doctor consults, laboratory tests, etc. may become a priority for the man as compared to the woman with diabetes. Underrepresentation of women in cardiovascular clinical trials, again across the spectrum, whether it's a hypertension trial, coronary artery disease trial, diabetes trial, women are underrepresented, which means we learn less, we have knowledge gaps which adversely impact the women. Even the lipid medication, whether it's the addition by the physician or the adherence by the patient, it's really, really low in women as compared to men. Therapeutic inertia is also high and severely high in women as compared to men with diabetes. There are several social determinants of these differences. This is the gender impact which I was talking about, whether it's early marriage or medical and social complications or complete lack of preconception care, childhood experiences, housing, family income, so on and so forth. Everything seems to impact this evolution or occurrence of diabetes in women. Again, digitization, we know it's a great boon, but it also comes with a price that we pay. Women are less physically active and more sedentary, and that is rendering them more overweight, obese, as well as more prone to diabetes. Gender-wise pattern of physical activity has been studied, and guess what? Women, whether it's urban or rural, are the worst in recreational physical activity as compared to men, again leading them to more to non-communicable diseases like diabetes. So why women and diabetes? Diabetes in women is different, difficult, disabling, dismissed, and associated with more death. So let's come together and apply that gender lens, and I'm hoping that this astute crowd today or audience today that we have, some of you will raise that voice for gender specific guidelines that we all can apply for our patients. Thank you very much.